Hello and welcome back. This is Curiously Polar. My name is Chris Marquardt, and with me, as usual, is Henry. How are you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing good. We almost okay. So the thing is, when we're recording this the day before, we switch to winter time, to away from daylight saving time. And I was really adamant of checking this out, and it worked out because you're in Romania and you also switched yesterday. But I had another recording yesterday with someone in the United States, and they switch a week later. So that turned into disaster. And I found out why why the Americans switch a week later, because of the candy manufacturers, because they want to have the switch after Halloween so they can sell their candy for an hour longer. It's weird. It's totally weird. And it's nothing to do with this show and with the Arctic topics, but I think this dates the show well. This is the 26th of October 2020.
It is indeed. End of October. Unbelievable.
In our remote settings and in all the online internet glory. So this is an audio podcast, but of course it's also a video podcast. Henry, you look better than ever. You just switched to a different camera.
Thank you. You got a new haircut.
I got a haircut. once every 3 months right now, maybe 2.5.
I think that's quite important that we have visual improvements every now and then, and keep the video version of that podcast important and interesting.
Well, it's a constant learning experience. Audience. And I know that a lot of people who are watching this spend a lot of time in front of their screens right now in video conferences, and they're probably fed up with the look and the sound of Zoom. So that's why we're working on making this as good as we can. So here we are with an episode titled The Last Surrender. What is that about?
It's about history. And I got just caught up last week in some history. And you know how it is when you start something on Wikipedia or digging in a book.
You go down a rabbit hole. That's what you do.
Exactly. And that was actually a quite deep rabbit hole, and I just came from A to B, from B to Z, and I ended up somewhere where I never have been before. I mean, I travel a lot to Spitsbergen, and I know quite some history there, and of course also some wartime history, but I never really got into certain aspects of the wartime. Not really into certain missions, let's put it that way.
So let's put Spitsbergen on the map, or Svalbard. Here's the world map. Here is this place.
Yeah, Svalbard is north of Norway.
Yeah.
And
Spitsbergen is the left Greenland? The left island, the western island of it, pretty much, the big archipelago. And that's what it's called in many places, like in Germany, for example. But the international term for the whole thing is Svalbard. So
indeed, so the whole archipelago is Svalbard. And I came across a very interesting story, and that was the weather stations of all involved parties during World War II. And they had a number of weather stations across the Arctic because, obviously, a lot of the World War II took place on the Atlantic, on the North Atlantic. And if you want to predict weather of the North Atlantic, you have to understand how the weather forms, and you have to make predictions. And those predictions took place mainly on very, very remote places. And a lot of nations involved started using weather ships. So they actually refitted certain fish trawlers and sent them onto very interesting places somewhere in the middle of nowhere, where they just have held their position through gale force like storms and have done nothing else but observing the weather and just recorded a number of variables and have just reported them to their headquarters. And there the meteorologists have basically just put them into models and just forecasted the weather. And that was very interesting when you see the history of which party has put up weather stations where, In Greenland, for example, along the east coast, you have a number of stations used by the Allied forces, mainly by Denmark, by England, and the US. And then Germany came into place and used the same coastline, a little bit further north. They tried to go north of Scoresby Sound and accidentally got discovered by the freshly established Sirius patrol, which is like a dog sledge patrol of Denmark and Greenlanders, supported by the US back then, and they are just patrolling the northeast of Greenland, which is super remote, super vast. It's a huge area, and they're just on the run for days. On one stretch, just to really patrol the area and just report if some enemy movements can be observed. And they actually stumbled across two Germans who were just hunting on a in a fjord, in a very remote fjord. And as soon as the Germans discovered the patrol, like three men, one Danish and two Greenlanders, they just left everything behind and just fled back to the place where they came from, which is a fjord further. And that was just like a back and forth. So the Sirius patrol tried to get closer to the Germans. The Germans pushed them back. And at one point, the commander of the German party, together with two more people, just took the leader of the patrol, the Danish leader, into captivity. And later on, because he was a very experienced dog sledge driver, they decided that the commander of the German mission and the captain of the Sirius patrol are going just on a reconnaissance mission together. It was kind of a stupid idea because the Danish guy just took the German guy into captivity. And by that, the whole mission just got reported back to the US. The US tried to bombard the weather station. You can see there's a lot of, of back and
Just let me interrupt you here because I think that was also part of that whole weather station system, where was that they were also not just there for the weather, they were also partially watching for military activities of the others. I mean, do you remember when we visited the lighthouse up in down in Lofoten, and down in Lofoten, yes, seen from Svalbard, but up in Lofoten seen from here, where we visited the lighthouse? What was that? Yes.
Skrolsvik.
Right, and
Skrolsvik, yeah.
And and the former lighthouse keeper gave us a tour, and he told us that they had to make weather measurements there because it's a very exposed place and it's pretty good to do weather measurements, but they also had to report back any enemy movements that they might see from Indeed. The lighthouse. So it's an interesting mix of things that happens in war times,
and especially in the area up further north, where you have like Svalbard or Greenland. You have very, very little places where you can actually place some buildings that remain for a certain period. So those weather stations were quite close to each other. And Svalbard had a very special status. We talked about the Svalbard Treaty, went into place, I think, 1920, so prior to World War II. And that means that the government of Norway, even though Norway got overrun by the Germans, hoped that the Svalbard Treaty will be respected by all parties, and obviously it really didn't. So all the clauses about not spending military personnel there and have no military action in Svalbard just got dismissed at a certain point. Even though there was not big action because there's not much infrastructure, but the Germans tried to take over the coal mines, and the Allies tried to fight back, and they just established at very certain locations weather stations where they thought that they have a very good overview, not only over the area but also into the direction where the weather where they thought the weather forms. And of course, if you have the station so close, you will have at certain points enemy contact. But that particular mission started in September 44. So that is very, very late in World War II. There were a number of stations established already, and they got established for winter or for two, but no station really lasted for like 5 years or 4 years. It was really not that significant time. They just got re-established later on if the position the station was on was considered useful, but that particular one was brand new. And when you consider the exploration history of Svalbard, then it's quite amazing to see that the location they chose is really remote. It's basically at the end of the world. And if you could just put the card the map back on, we can have a look at the whole archipelago. You see the large island of Spitsbergen, and in the northeast you see Nordøstland, and North Eastland. This is like one of the remote places, very difficult to go to, have the largest glacier by area in Europe. And that's the place where they decided to establish a weather station. You see the top fjord, the largest fjord coming from the north, it's Ripefjord. And on the eastern shore of that fjord, they decided to establish that base. And they selected a man for that mission who is educated as a teacher, and he was a geography teacher. He was just teaching students, and because of his expertise in geography and geology, they decided to take him into the weather service of the Wehrmacht, and there he was leading the weather service unit in Tromsø, and just got selected to lead a group of 11 men to build up that station there. Those 11 men were mainly scientists. So they were just selected to really observe the weather, make the reports, and just stay put there. And then they had like two or three of the mission who actually were soldiers in case there's enemy contact. So they brought in material to build the hut, to build the whole station there. For 11 people.
Where around this fjord was the station? More towards the sea? More towards the inside?
It's very in the interior, in the southeastern corner of
that fjord. Okay, so we're zooming
in. You see the island there? North of the island on the right side, that's where exactly over there. That's where the station was established. And they've built up the station. Well, from pre-made assembled stuff they brought in, and they didn't only brought in the station themselves and all the gear and equipment they needed, they brought in provisions for a number of years, and that in the end was kind of lucky, because even though they reported very regularly, like three times a day, they took measurements every 3 hours. So they had a huge batch of information they needed to gather. Every 3 hours, they gathered those information three times a day to report it, so-called program times. They reported that back to the headquarters in Tromsø, and they back to the headquarters in Germany. But in May 1945, they had a last radio call from Tromsø saying that they need to reorganize things, and after that, the whole contact just was gone. There was no contact back home, no contact back to their headquarters. They tried to reach them, and then they switched to channels they knew were used by their allies, and figured that Germany has surrendered and the war was over. They in fact got note of the war crimes the allies discovered very quickly after the surrendering, and they were discussing about that. There were very young men there, around 20 and 20 years of age, and they were completely surprised by the conviction of the war crimes that German soldiers were supposed to have participated in. And the head of the mission, Wilhelm Dege, decided to switch off those channels and not let those information overrun the mission. So he decided, as long as they have no contact to anyone else, they just continue gathering the weather data. So this weather station.
So they didn't know anything that happened. They were just doing their job.
Exactly. They were just scientific, personal, not included in much more. And the decision was to take the mission of that wartime weather station into just a regular weather station. So they just continued with the exact same set of information, and they changed the reporting. So they didn't report to the frequency of the German headquarters any longer, but they just went onto a public channel they knew was observed by the Allies. And they just did. They just reported for weeks, for months actually, until at some point that got caught up and the Allies decided to send a ship, which was in fact a Norwegian seal hunter. And that seal hunter vessel just came in September, in the 4th of September 1945. So we draw back, the surrender was in the beginning of May, and they just stayed put for month until September 45. Then the sealing vessel came in, the captain came ashore, and the captain apparently was someone the commander of the mission, Wilhelm Dege, already knew from previous explorations in Svalbard, because he traveled to Svalbard before on private geological expeditions, and this particular sealing vessel captain brought him to one or two of those expeditions. And that was quite interesting, because suddenly there were enemies, and the sealing captain was kind of the official to negotiate the surrendering of the last armed German forces. And the scientist who was the commander-in-chief there surrendered literally by handing over his service pistol. And they had a celebration dinner before then getting onto the sealing vessel. They headed back to Tromsø, where they went into imprisonment for a few months, and then they returned back at the end of 45 to Germany and were completely struck by the level of destroyment. I was just, they didn't expect it, anything like that. And that was a very interesting story to read. Wilhelm Dege later turned back as a teacher. He became a professor at the university, actually, in geography and geology. And he wrote a number of books on that particular mission, which I never came or stumbled across until now. And it's definitely worth a read. They're not only available in German, a lot of translations are into English, which is definitely a recommendation to have a look into that.
That's a pretty wild story. It's a very wild story indeed.
I mean, just imagine you were at the end of the world, and you know that there is nobody around you any longer.
You know, but that's, I mean, today, if you're on a ship out there somewhere, you have GPS, you have some radio communication, but even that is not everywhere. And then you're kind of cut off unless you have like a satellite phone with you. You can still get into these situations, but you know how to get out of them again because you're not stranded there for months. There are still a lot of the sea floor that is uncharted, so there's still a lot of areas where you have to go by sonar and by like touch and feel and ears and eyes, but don't have GPS data for some places. So it is really interesting. I mean, even the map that we look at here, that's an open street map, and it is very coarse, right? It's not as detailed as it could be. We have another map here that gives us a bit more context here. So, but still, I mean, you can get cut off to in places, and especially back then when the internet wasn't there and nothing was there, you only had radio communication and one-way radio communication after a certain point, where you just shout in the void and you hope someone listens to it and hears it.
For example, it was a big trouble in East Greenland. The stations in East Greenland had really big troubles to get their message through to Tromsø. The signal was interfered very often, and they were just cut off communication for quite some time. That's completely wild times. I mean, we can't really imagine that nowadays. We have all those search and rescue capabilities pretty much everywhere where we go. And even if you go on your own expedition, in certain areas like Greenland, you just simply have to have your recovery insurance there. You have to have a fallback plan.
And it's better you have a doctor on board because the next hospital is possibly days or even longer away. So,
indeed.
Yeah.
But if you come back to the last map, please. Of course. Where we have the number of German weather stations, where you can see the different stations in East Greenland. There are four different dots. Two of them have been established, Holzauge in 1942 and 1943. It's very difficult to translate some of those. Baarsgeiger the year later. So basically what they figured in that year is that they got discovered. So they tried to move, and they moved actually further north then. Then there were two more attempts to establish in 44, but they got just pushed back by the Danes and the US. And then you see around Svalbard, you have a big number of stations. And the strategy here was to actually take over existing stations from the Norwegians and the Danes after they got occupied by Germany, which wasn't that easy as it sounds. Because it's just very remote. And if you see, for example, Torget and Slatis and Helhus, they are on very small remote islands in the Barents Sea. So approaching them is very difficult. We have Bjørnøya and Hinlopen. And they just reported for quite some time the weather report to the Allies before the Germans reoccupied them or occupied them and then established their first own ones later in that time. And they even moved further east towards Franz Josef Land, where you have Schatzgräber, which was established in the same year, like Kreuzritter, a year before the story we just talked about. So those stations, you can see they were just built up for a season, for one season, lasted not very, very long. So there is no real contingency there. It's a very difficult place, especially when you consider the times back in the days.
Yeah. Interesting. Very interesting. Yeah, history has a lot of stories, and I'm very glad that some of those have been recorded and can be retold again, because that is, I mean, it's just a fascinating look at a very strange time in our last 100 years.
True story.
Okie dokie. Yeah, that was the last surrender. Happened in the Arctic, and really puts things in a different perspective. So that was it for this episode. Thanks, Henry, for your time. And you out there, tell us what you think about our episodes. We want to know if we have any topics that are dearly missed. Do you want to get in a deeper insight on something or an update on a previous topic? Contact us. We have an email address, info@curiouslypolar.com. We have online presence on the web at curiouslypolar.com, on Twitter at curiouslypolar, and on Insta at curiouslypolar. And we'll be back. I guess we're regular back to a weekly schedule, so you should be able to expect us to be back in a week from now. Until then, everyone, take care. Bye-bye.